Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for coming to this campus lecture entitled The Truth About Communism by Yeonmi Park. My name is Pierce Sandlin, and I have been honored to serve as the chairman of the Wake Forest chapter of Young Americans for Freedom over the last 2 years. Through this, members of my organization and I have had the opportunity to engage in activism projects on campus, such as our annual 9/11 Never Forget project, where we pay tribute to those who passed during the tragedy. Through this, we have learned about our great nation and have striven to protect the freedoms that it provides. Before we get started, I would like to note that disruptive activities that prevent our speaker's message from being heard are not consistent with the university's policy on free expression. The university will issue up to 3 warnings to the audience asking that they stop these activities. This is the first of such warnings. Please refrain from interrupting our guest speaker during the event, as we will have question and answer time once she is finished speaking. Now I would like to thank those who have generously helped support this event. First, I would like to thank Young America's Foundation for their work with students across the country and their ability to secure lectures by renowned individuals helping to secure values for our next generation. They help preserve America's values like personal freedom, limited government, and free enterprise. Importantly, this event is part of our YAF's Preserving American Liberty and Freedom lecture series. We are fortunate that it is generously sponsored by Mr. Keith Work. I'd also like to thank the members of this chapter here at Wake Forest and our executive board who have helped participate in our projects. I'd like to also thank the Wake Forest University Office of Student Engagement and SAFE for helping fund and plan this event. And finally, I would like to thank the Wake Forest faculty and staff who have assisted with this event and its promotion. We appreciate your dedication to the student body and furthering their education on campus. Once again, thank you. With the support of these remarkable individuals and organizations, we can host a woman who has, in her short life, experienced things far beyond what we can imagine here in America. Yeonmi Park, best known for her harrowing escape from North Korea and human rights activism, has a one-of-a-kind story. Born in North Korea, she grew up in a punishing society devoted to the worship of Kim Jong-il. But at the age of 13, her and her family made a daring escape to China in an attempt to flee from tyranny. In her viral talks, she urges her audiences to recognize and also to resist the oppression that exists in North Korea and around the world. Growing up in Hasan, North Korea, it was normal for her to see dead bodies as she walked to school, and she would be so hungry that she ate wild plants. After watching a pirated copy of the Titanic, the veil of tyranny began to fall. Having caught a glimpse of the free world, she realized that her experience in life wasn't the only one, and she sought to find a way out. In 2007, Park's sister and a friend of hers escaped. Then she and her mother followed them to China. But before they could locate her sister, her and her mother were both sold separately to Chinese human traffickers. In 2009, Park and her mother crossed the Gobi Desert into Mongolia in negative 40 degree temperatures. They found freedom eventually in South Korea. She accounts this incredible story in her searing memoir, In Order to Live, A North Korean Girl's Journey to Freedom, and in the insightful moving talks based on her experiences. An insightful and candid speaker, Park is fast becoming a leading voice of oppressed people around the world. Park is also the author of While Time Remains, A North Korean Defector's Search for Freedom in America, which was published in February of this year. Tonight, we have the opportunity to hear from Yeonmi Park about her experiences living under the North Korean regime and how this has shaped her views about communism and the rest of the world. So as she gives this lecture entitled The Truth About Communism, I am honored to welcome her, Yeonmi Park, an activist for American freedom and freedom around the world.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Oh, wow, I'm so humbled and grateful to be here. I somehow, with North Carolina, I have a very special connection to this place. I've never been here, but I heard about this place a lot because when I came to for the first time in America, I went to study at Columbia University. And whenever I go to my class, you know, we have to introduce ourselves in the beginning of the class. And then I said, you know, hello everyone, my name is Yeonmi Park, I'm from North Carolina, no, North Korea, and nobody said anything. At the end of the class, some guy came up to me, hey, are you from North Carolina? Where? Me too. And that says like, oh, maybe North Carolina is similar to North Korea. But hell no. I came here today and I just could not believe this is a heaven on earth. And I could not even just believe how many trees there were and how many leaves on the ground. I'm here to talk about the truth about communism today. As a survivor of communism, I do feel this duty to share my story. I see that in the current world, especially in America, there are a lot of people remember the victims of slavery. Of course we have to, right? It's a part of American history and part of humanity's history. But turns out there are a lot of people educated in their schools hearing about slavery, not quite hearing about the victims of communism. Do you guys know that in the 20th century alone, there are more than 100 million human beings died because of communism? 65 million alone in China, 20 million alone in Soviet Union. And death caused by communism is continuing till 21st century right now while we are in this room. I was sold as a sex slave, just over $200 at 13 in China, and this is because of communism. Before I will share why I escaped from North Korea, I really want to depict life under socialism. What it feels like living in socialist paradise, right? I was born in 1993 in the city, little city called Haesan in North Korea. And I don't know how many of you guys have ever seen the picture of North Korea at nighttime. Have you ever seen the satellite picture of North Korea at nighttime? Right, a lot of you. It is truly the darkest place in the whole world. In the 21st century, guys, North Korea does not even have electricity, not to mention internet. And I often tell my friends at Columbia, the ones that believe in climate change and want to fight for the, you know, no impact feature, like, just go to North Korea. We have zero impact. There's no noise pollution. There's no light pollution. There are no cars. There's no fuel. There's nothing. It's literally nothing. But people living in there, it's a different story. I was born in a what's so-called normal in the middle-class family. I had one older sister. And the day I was born, in a way, before even I came out of my mother's tummy, my life was determined for me by the Communist Party in North Korea. How come? So North Korea is I think for you guys it's easier to understand because this same trend is happening in America. How is currently America being divided based on your skin color? Based on your skin color, they say who is responsible for slavery, who should be privileged, who is guilty. Just like that in North Korea, when we are born in the country, we are divided based on what our ancestors did. So when I was born there, apparently my great-grandfather on my mother's side that I've never even met, he was a landowner. He had a tiny bit of land in his house, and therefore, he was marked as a landowner. So anybody who was born in that family was marked as oppressors. They said that our genetics were oppressive. So it's in a way, it's exact same thing that how America is now playing this game with race and skin color. North Korea is playing the same theory with just like your ancestors' crime. So supposedly the most equitable, most equal country on earth that is called the socialist paradise, North Korea, there are 51 different classes in the country. Can you imagine 51 different classes in a country that is homogeneous nation? The Koreans, unlike America, it's not an immigrant country. We are in that land for 5,000 years, speaking the same language, same genetics, eating kimchi, all our existence. And then how come a government comes in 1945, divides people in that? And so basically in these 51 different classes, we have three categories, big categories they divided us into. Number one category is called the royal class, royalty class, the top third. The second is wavering class in the middle. The last is a hustler class. And just think about the fruits, guys. It's easy to understand. Top class in North Korea is called tomatoes. because you are red outside and you are red inside. Therefore, there's no doubt that you believe in communism. You believe this ideology in your core belief. So that's for, therefore, governments mark you as a royal class. The second, the middle class called the wavering class, is you are called apples, right? Guys, apples, red outside, but what about inside? Is it red? No, it's white. Therefore, they're quite not sure that if you believe in this truly, that you need government surveillance, that middle third. The last bottom is hostile class. You're so screwed because you're grape. You're not even red outside. You're completely having no trace of believing in communism. Therefore, you're hostile class. Government's gonna persecute you throughout generation after generation. There's no end to that. Your family, anybody born in that bloodline, gonna persecute it until they died when they're born. So governments divide people into different classes, and this division is helping the government because why? Because nobody trusts each other. Even in the classroom, there's no words in, guys, in North Korea word called friends. You cannot be friends with somebody as a child. There's only one word that we know is comrade. When you're a comrade, you're serving the different purpose. You're not sharing your deep secrets and being a human to each other. You're there to fight for the revolution of your country. And there is no word love in North Korea. Do you know why? Because if you love somebody, you're not gonna love the dictator as much. So government eliminated words like love from our dictionary. Kim Jong-un banned Mother's Day a few years ago. The reason he banned Mother's Day for North Korean people is because if we love our mothers, we are not gonna love him as much. So even basic human love to their own mother, to their own children, to their partner, is denied in communism. The only thing that you need to live for and fight for is a survivor of the Communist Party and its ideology. You don't matter. And that's why they don't have a concept of human rights. By the time when I was going to school, like everybody else in North Korea, my everyday in school classroom was filled with hating you guys, American bastards. That was my entire education, guys. And if I said just Americans, that would get me executed because it's too polite. American bastard is a one word in North Korea. Even in my math books, my teachers say, there are four American bastards. If you kill two of them, how many Americans left to kill? And I would say as a child, two American bastards. But then this is a school where we are, every second we are brainwashed to believe that Kim Jong-il is God. He doesn't go to bathroom. And even his body dies, he's like Jesus Christ. His spirit is with us forever. When we die, we join him in a utopia, in a socialist utopia. That's what I believed. But in a daily life, it was the word misery doesn't do a justice. As a child in North Korea, I did not play with Barbies or Legos or Play-Dohs. I'm a mom right now. I see my son, his child is unbelievable. He has like Paw Patrol. I'm like, what is that? Fire truck, what is that? You know, in North Korea, we don't have any of those. Instead of playing with the Play-Dohs or Barbie-Dohs as a young girl in North Korea, I played with my friends catching cockroaches. And boys are so much faster than me. They catch cockroach a lot faster than me. And they catch it, and then they pop the belly of a cockroach out. Then do you know what's inside the belly of cockroach? There looks something like a brown rice in the tummy of a cockroach. Then these boys put them in their mouth. I was always envied that I wasn't as faster. My fanciest protein that I ate in North Korea was grasshoppers. They were delicious. And dragonflies. And now I'm in America. There are so many world leaders talking about how beneficial it is eating insects. Trust me, it's disgusting. Steak is far better than insects. Seriously. eating that, and as you can see, I'm on a high here, I'm very short, because of the severe malnutrition that North Korean people go through, we are 5 inch shorter than South Koreans in the South who live in a free democratic country. And also, why are we starving? Kim Jong-un tests like 40 nuclear weapon tests each year. And the one test cost of him the money that he can feed 25 million North Koreans entire year. If he does one last nuclear test, nobody in North Korea ever had to die from malnutrition. The reason why we are starving is because government don't want us to think for ourselves. If your stomach is full, what you gonna do? You have energy to think for something else other than your survival and find the food for the next meal. You're gonna start thinking about what's the meaning of life. You're gonna start reading philosophy. But when your tummy is empty, every meal is a battle to find. You have no time to think of anything else other than surviving. That's why North Koreans are starving. In the 90s, when I was a toddler, seeing dead bodies on the street was like looking at the trees. It's like every day you see dead bodies floating around. And then the cadres in the party member go to Kim Jong-il in the Pyongyang, in the capital, says, "Dear leader, there are millions of people dying from starvation. What shall we do?" Do you know what Kim Jong-il said? He said, "It's easy to do socialism when there are less of them. So let them die." This reminds me of current America, how humans are marked as a poison to Mother Earth. They say that humans are disease. Do you hear that? Often in our current America, how often that we dare to describe humans as a disease to Mother Earth? Mother Earth, what does that even mean? It's just Earth, right? And that is a core value of socialism, where human life doesn't matter. The only thing matters is the ideology of communism. They're willing to sacrifice entire population for their ideology. And that's why North Koreans are starving till this 21st century, why we are here in America, where our problem is having too much food. By the time in 2007, I turned 13. And by the 13, we could not find animal food. There's not enough even tree barks to go by. I was like around 50 pounds, and we couldn't survive anymore. So the only way for us to survive was escaping from North Korea. The reason that I knew about even anything about escape was because I lived in the border town of China. In North Korea, as I said, there's no internet, but there was also no map. I had no idea how the world looked like. Did you know that North Korea calendar does not begin when Jesus Christ was born? North Korea calendar begins when Kim Il-sung was born. It is a complete different planet. So at nighttime, I was in North Korea looking at the lights coming from Chinese side. And I thought, maybe if I go where the lights were, I could find a bowl of rice. And that's what I risked my life for. Right before my escape in 2007, end of March, I had one older sister that I wanted to escape with. And she was 16 years old. But then I got horrible stomachache. So my parents took me to a hospital. And here is the reality of government-free healthcare, guys. Do we not talk about how we want free healthcare by government all day here, right now, even in America? North Korea does officially have a free healthcare by the government because it's a socialist state. When my mother took me to a hospital, there was no x-ray machines, there was no CT scans. Doctors just simply rubbed my belly and then said to my parents, "She might have like appendicitis. We need to open her up today, otherwise she might like, it might burst in her." So they opened me up without any painkiller. And then when they opened my stomach up, I remember in this hospital bed, they tied me up and my stomach is coming out of me and stretching me, and I faint and coming back and screaming. And they realized what I had was actually malnutrition and just high fever and infection. So they got so embarrassed, they still removed my appendix and closed me back up. Don't worry, I'm gonna go see these doctors when I go back to North Korea. It's a complete malpractice. But after my surgery, I came out, I could not believe what I was seeing. A nurse in the hospital going, every patient, injecting the same needle, injecting every patient. And then they use a beer bottle from the trash dump to use as a drop. And that's why, guys, in North Korea, you don't die from cancer. Many things kills you way before cancer gets your life. Nobody dies from cancer in North Korea. When my grandmother passed away from starvation in her late 50s, and people came to the funeral and said, oh, she lived a long life, you should not be sad. In North Korea, women, anybody after 22, 23, you're considered as a mid-aged lady. I've turned 30 this year. I'm like considered ancient in North Korea, and now they call me a young girl in America. After this surgery, we realized we had to go to China to find some food. My sister, who left first while I was in the hospital, left me a note and saying, go find this lady, she will help you to go to China and find me there. I found this note and I found this lady with my mother, and for some reason, she wanted to help me to go to China. And I did not question her why she was helping me out of nowhere. Because crossing North Korean border is not like crossing American border from Mexico, guys. It is unbelievable. The North Korea is the poorest nation in the whole world, but their border is so secure that not even one single ant can cross. By the time when I was crossing 2007, it was not as bad. They had every 10 meters with the guards with the machine guns. And nowadays, they bury the landmines in their border. And they remove the troops. And then, so not even one single animal can cross the border. But by the time, we still could get out through the brokers who bribed these border guards. And the border guards who received the bribery would letting me go. So I crossed the Yalu River on the ice with my mother into China in 2007. When I got the Chinese side of the border, I could look back North Korea. It was complete pitch black darkness. And then when we were at the riverbank after this crossing this river, the men who were receiving us said, I want to have sex with her. And at 13, I did not know what that was because in North Korea, we don't have a sex education. And then my mother offered herself instead of me, so she got raped in front of me. And then these people in China who received us told us our new fate in China. They said, if you want to be fed in China, you need to be sold as a sex slave. And do you remember, guys, with the Chinese one-child policy? Chinese communist regime thought it would be a good idea for people to have only one kid per family. They aborted so many girls, and they kept so many boys instead. Now they are lacking 33 million men in China cannot find wives. So Chinese government is nervous about this. There are 33 million young men who are angry, cannot even find the basic thing, like finding your mate. They might start a revolution. So they want to appease these young men who are angry. How do they want to appease them? CCP came up idea, oh, we can give them sex slaves. Then they might not get as angry about the reality of living in a socialism in China. So that's why the state-sponsored human trafficking happening in China. My mother was sold for $65 in 2007, and they sold me over $200. The reason I was more expensive than my mother was because I was a child virgin. And a lot of Chinese men love taking child virginity, so they give more money to buy child virgins. So after they sold my mom separately and sold me separately, I was sold another human trafficker as a sex slave. And I was his sex toy for 2 years, from 13 to 15. But here's the reality, guys. Being sold as a sex slave in China, in a way, like a 2-in-1 man, was the best thing could happen to me. Because there are 4 places that North Korean women end up when they go to China. Right now, there are currently 300,000 North Korean women in China live as sex slaves. Number one place they buy us is organ harvesters. Do you know in China, if you need an organ, you can receive it within 2 hours? How come somebody matches your genetic code exactly, dies in 2 hours, and you get the organ? How is that possible? Because of North Korean women. They buy us for less than $100. They tie us in a basement. And then whenever they get the request to buy the organ, they open us while we are alive, because that's why how you keep the organs the freshest, when you keep us alive and take our organs one by one. And then they just discard our body afterwards. Number two place that they buy North Koreans are brothels. I've been to these brothels where in a room there are no single windows, a size of room that can fit not even queen beds, like twin bed. They put a girl in there and they don't want to even spare the minute to feed her, so they don't feed her. They drug her and then let her raped 500 times a day, constantly, without break. Because it costs more money for this girl to be taken care of by the owner than buying a new girl. So usually, these girls don't last more than 3 to 6 months in the brothel, getting raped thousands of times each day. Third place they buy North Korean women are in the rural villages where the farmers and the poor people. The men who cannot buy a woman by themselves, the village of men chip in. They chip in like $1, $5, $20 each family. And then they gather the money, they buy one girl, and they go around gang rape her until she dies. And then they buy a new girl. So the fact that I was sold to a man who just raped me alone, it was the best blessing could happen to me as a North Korean defector in China. And by the 2 years of Mark in China as a slave, there was a hope came to me, because we met another North Korean defector woman, and she somehow met a Christian missionaries from South Korea that were rescuing North Korean defectors. These Christian missionaries from South Korea came to China risking their lives, rescuing us. And then we met them and they said there was a way to be free. And at 15, in 2009, were you guys even born in 2009? You were, thank God, you're not that young. I was 15 years old in China, and then they said, there is a way to be safe, there's a way to be free. And I did not know the word free. So I asked these missionaries, like, what do you mean that I'm gonna be free? And this person said, I mean, like, how would you explain freedom to a North Korean? You're gonna say things like, it's a freedom of assembly, it's a freedom of religion, freedom of speech, right? We are not gonna get the concept. This missionary did the perfect job, said, sweetie, if you go to South Korea, you can watch K-dramas and you can wear jeans and nobody gonna arrest you for that. And I couldn't believe it. there is a country where you can go and decide what to wear for yourself, what to watch, because in North Korea, if you watch a wrong movie that was not sanctioned by the government, you literally get executed for watching a wrong movie. And I couldn't believe there are individuals have that much freedom in South Korea where people decide what to wear, what to watch. So I said, I'm going to risk my life for that. So I literally risked my life for watching K-dramas and wearing jeans at 15. And this time, the journey was more arduous. It was not crossing the frozen river. This time around, the journey was that we had walk across frozen Gobi Desert by foot from China to Mongolia. I remember the night that I stood on the desert. I've never seen desert in my life. I couldn't believe that there's nothing that indicates you if you are going forward or backwards or on the side. It's a complete empty land. And then by some miracle, it was like minus 40 degrees in 2009 in February. If we didn't die from the cold, we might reach Mongolia and get rescued in Mongolia. I didn't make it to Mongolia, didn't die that night, and then got arrested by Mongolian soldiers. And eventually, they helped me to go through South Korea. And then, after 5 years of in South Korea, I came to the United States of America, the promised land. I was so excited. The first time I came to America, I did not go to New York City, thankfully not. I did go to Tyler, Texas. Do you guys know where Tyler, Texas is? It's a tiny city or like suburb in Texas. And the first places people took me in America was Walmart. I went to Walmart to prepare to live in the dorm in Tyler, and my jaw dropped. I went to pick up apples. Did you know there are dozens types of apples? Honey, crispy, I mean like, could not believe it. I went to there to buy a toothbrush and toothpaste, and there is a whole cavity care, there's a whitening, there's a dozens types of the toothpaste and toothbrush. And I was like, I couldn't believe it. Capitalism is a pure miracle. Only God can make it. It's a pure miracle that's sent to us as a humanity. That it creates need, it meets our need, and make our life so comfortable. I was like, this is the best country. I'm never living here again. And second time around, I was coming to America this time. I was going to study at Columbia University in New York City. This time around, it was me living here permanently and going to Ivy League school as a former sex slave, as somebody who just learned English by watching Friends. Prior to I was coming to Columbia in 2016, in South Korea, one day I Googled how to learn English, and they say, watch American TV shows. What do I watch? They say, watch Friends or Sex and the City or some other shows. I picked Friends. I watched like 30 times from season 1 to 10. That's how I learned English. And now I go to Columbia University. The first day, I couldn't believe it this time, because I literally thought I was time-traveled back to North Korea. The professors, the things they were saying in our classrooms were exactly the same things that my North Korean teachers were teaching us inside North Korea. Anti-freedom, anti-capitalism, anti-America, anti-West, the sentiment was so high and so intense, even Kim Jong-un cannot beat that. The passion that Columbia professors and Columbia students have to hate America. Like literally in my first orientation, I remember my professor was saying, you guys need to be woke. And I thought, like, I'm awake. How can I be more awake than this? And then she noticed that I was a foreign student. So I was like, oh, let me give you an example of being woke. Who likes to read Jane Austen? And I love reading Jane Austen. Any of you reading Jane Austen here? Yay! We have some fan club here. And my professor was saying, to notice hidden systemic racism, that's how you being woke, is that somehow Jane Austen conveyed in her books that only white men are capable of logical thinking. So by reading her work, you're perpetuating systemic racism on other minority groups. That's how you need to be woke. And it was like, it was unbelievable. And it's like a North Korean classroom where American bastards in the air that we breathe. American bastards are everywhere that we go. We always have to look for our enemies. They keep you this paranoia. And then this is a final stroke that I came to. The professors were saying literally things like, math is racist. And math is made up by white men to oppress other minority. And do you know what I learned in North Korea about math? One day, my professor asked me in the classroom, it's like I was in seven or something, like, what is 1 + 1? What's 1 + 1, guys? Great, you know the answer. Well, me too, I said 2. But my teacher, this is my teacher in North Korea, said, wrong. Because my dear leader at the time, Kim Jong-il, discovered that adding one drop of water to another drop of water, what does it become? It becomes bigger one. It's not 2. That is how Kim Jong-il proved that math was racist, to control minority by white men. And this same BS is being taught at one of the elite institutions in America in the 21st century. I don't know what happened to you guys. I only came to this country in 2016. I don't know the time before what could possibly have gone wrong that we are in this situation where we are even doubting what's 1 + 1. But I know when you copy the most oppressive nation in human history, it cannot be a good thing. We cannot be literally copying North Korea, guys. Because we know what happened to North Korean people. I'm a believer now, and I prayed God one day, ask him, like, why God? Why do you allow the suffering of North Korean people for this long, like 80 years? Do you know how many North Korean people made it to freedom over the last 80 years? How many of us in America currently from North Korea? In 80 years, only 209 of us made it. It is that hard to be free. And then God told me, say that, the reason why I kept North Korea that way is because I wanted to remind humanity that this is what happens when individuals lose their liberty. And this is why we need to stand up when we see these warning signs that is occurring in current America. You might think, I heard that a lot of you not interested in politics, but a lot of you some do. Why do you have to care about politics? It seems like it doesn't matter, right? Just look at North Korea and South Korea. Same country, same history, same genetics, same culture. They same country, one country accepted free democratic, free market system like from America. One country got a system from Soviet Union, Stalin's Soviet Union, and got a collectivism and equity driven that socialist paradise. What happened? South Korea became the country of Samsung, BTS. Anybody follow BTS here? Literally, it is the 10th largest economy in the whole world. One country that got a different political idea with the same people, known for the starvation, Holocaust, and known for the most hermit kingdom, most isolated and closed country in the human history. So we do have to care about politics if we do not end up like North Korea. So we can maintain this land as a nation that gives a platform to a North Korean person like me. If in North Korea, only 5% of people go to college in university, and 1% of them are women. And the people who can select to go to universities are not the ones who are the brightest and works hard. It is the ones that got the right kind of ancestors. That if you happen to have an ancestor that believed in the communism when Kim Il-sung was around, you would go to university. So if we want to keep this country this as beautiful as free, I hope you can join me today to speak for freedom. And also, if you join me today, to remember the victims of communism, because this genocide is continuing. And I'm so grateful for you not yelling at me and coming to this Wednesday evening to hear my story. Thank you so much, everyone. And I'm going to open up the floor for the questions. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Hey, y'all. Thanks for coming out tonight. Now we're going to open up the floor for the Q&A session. If you have a question for Yeonmi Park, please make your way towards the back and form a line behind my colleague over there. And when you ask your question, you're going to stand right here. And there's going to be an orange tape that you'll see. And I'll just hold the mic for you. Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us. That was really powerful.
Oh, thank you.
What can we do in North Carolina to help, especially with sex trafficking in China?
Oh, that's a really good question. I've been trying my best for the last decade to raise awareness about this modern-day human trafficking and modern-day slavery that is sponsored by Chinese Communist Party. The reason it's so hard in current America is because Hollywood is in the pockets of CCP. Our politicians in this in the pockets of CCP. Our corporations in the pockets of CCP. That's why there's no problem for Michelle Obama to speak up for the girls that are captured by ISIS and Boko Haram. Nobody in the mainstream ever want to stand up for the girls that were captured by CCP. So I think that is the thing we need to understand as a nation, to threat of China, threat of CCP. It's not just some economic miracle that we see in China. There's a lot of dark side that this country, this Communist Party is committing in that nation. And our politicians who gets money, you know, even though universities get funding from China, and they don't want to speak up about this crisis. So I hope that we can talk to our family members. We can share the links on social media so more American people hear this news, because there's no news coming out of mainstream media to talk about this issue. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Hi, I wanted to ask, isn't it a little scary to speak so openly about the North Korean government? Are you a little afraid about what might happen? I just wanted to know more about that aspect of this whole thing.
Yeah, thank you. I know when I became American last year, guys. So I'm a little bastard like you. Thank you. And until that point, I was protected by South Korean intelligence, and I was informed that I was a killing list of Kim Jong-un for a long time now. But the interesting enough, when I became American, the South Korean intelligence was like, okay, we're done with your responsibility of protecting you. You are not going to America. It's a much powerful country. They have more resources. I'm sure they can protect you better. So now I'm an American citizen. I got a call from FBI to say that they want to invite me to speak at one of their campuses in Texas. So I was so excited to go to FBI, telling them my story, and letting them know what's happening in China, and also how they can protect my security. 2 days before my event at FBI, head of diversity calls me. Did you know that's somebody's job, is being a head of diversity? And this lady calls me saying, we have to cancel your event because of your political opinions. It's funny because that same month, ironically, I became American, and in my citizenship test, did you know when foreigners become American, we have to take the citizenship test? My interviewer said, have you ever persecuted anybody for their political opinion? If I said yes, I could not be an American. So that FBI needs to stripping her citizenship away right now. So since then, I don't have any protection with the American government. And also, unfortunately, I live in New York City. I mean, before North Korean agents kills me, some crazy homeless guy might kill me first. So I don't worry about North Korean agent anymore. I'm more worrying about like crazy people on the street in New York City every day. So, well, we will see how long I can last. Thank you so much.
Hello. I was also like a Chinese from the mainland, and I was so moved by your speech today. And back in like 2016, at your age, when you came to America, I was still like a high school student and a CCP supporter. But with 4 years education in university, and with and witnessed the like the pandemic in the 3 years, I started to know the truth and to discover like the secrets of the what CCP they wouldn't tell us. And that's also the reason why I came here for studying in America. But the situation is like a lot of students, like classmates around myself, is also like from Chinese people. They come from the mainland, but they tend not to be like to speak up politics and to keep silence, including of these problems. And I can know their feelings because like their families and me, the same to me. They get a profit from the reform and the economic growth in the past 30 years or 40 years in China, in China government or the entire China. So what do you suggest like we can do to them to let them to speak out, speak for the politics, and they started to question the like the truth hided by the CCP?
Yeah, thank you so much. I just want to be clear. I have nothing to against with Chinese people. I just do not like the CCP. Because we need to always separate government with the people. And it's even Chinese people are the victims of this horrible regime. As you can see, even though last 30 years, Chinese Communist Party did lift people out of poverty, 800 million of them, almost a billion people got lifted from poverty, not because of CCP, but also because of free market. But we all thought somehow the economic freedom, economic prosperity gonna bring a political freedom. What we are noticing is not. China is becoming every single day more like North Korea, becoming a police state, especially aided by this modern technology, the facial recognition and AI. So this is a lesson for all of us to learn. Even though capitalism does give a lot of freedom to individuals, that political freedom needs to be fought actively by the citizens. And I do think that because the Chinese people were very content with the economic growth, because they're also like us starving. I mean, literally more than 60 million people died under Mao. They were just like happy, they were getting fed. And then they forgot about the political freedom part. And now, they don't have it. And when you don't have political freedom, the economic freedom is not promised at all. So I really hope it is a shared struggle. It's a shared struggle for humanity to fight for freedom. And the tyrannies, the dictators work together. So people who want to be free, I think we should work together too. And at least for now, in China, the consequences are not as bad as North Korea. So I really hope that there is a hope if more people in China wake up from their brainwashing and demand that political freedom. But I know it will cost a lot of lives and blood, and freedom is not free, but it's worth fighting for. So thank you for your courage. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you again for coming. I just wanted to ask, you mentioned it sounds like you became a Christian at some point, and I wanted to ask if that was when you met the South Korean missionaries or if that was in the US or what the story was behind that.
So honestly, when I met Christian missionaries in China at 15, the deal was that I had to become Christian to get rescued by these missionaries. But you're like so desperate. If somebody brought a rock, asked me to believe in it, I would have believed in it. it was not a free choice, free wording. I was so desperate. Anything can get me out of that misery, I would have lived in it. So I don't even know at the time I was actually a believer or not. And then go to South Korea, I had a moment of resentment because I was sick of dogma. You know, I was so sick of this dogma where you have to believe to survive. So I had like proudly atheist. I was like, I'm so logical, I'm so smart, I'm not gonna believe any God. And that all gone away the day when I held my son in my arms as a mother in 2018 in Chicago. When I just held my son in my arms, I just knew there's no way I could have made this life. It was only God could have done it. And at that point, it just didn't need the words to convince me God is real or not. It just say it transcends the human capacity. And I was very blessed. I was touched by God that way. And since then, I'm a Christian. But until that moment, I had a period of atheist and searching for that. Yeah. Thank you.
Hey, thank you for the speech. It's very powerful. I'm a senior here on campus, and I want to ask a question that's really related to this student body. Mm-hmm. And it is, we're seeing like a lot of kids who are born in those communist regimes come into the democratic world, to the US, to Europe for study, but their parents are still in these communist countries. So we're seeing this huge divide between the democratic world versus the communist world. Mm-hmm. And because, you know, people receive different informations. Mm-hmm. And, you know, parents from these communist world, they think they're right, and they think they're thinking through their heart. And what would be your advice to families like this to solve this huge, huge divide that is really causing a lot of traumatic moments for these kids?
Right. It's a real struggle. I know even like I had a lot of personally classmates at Columbia too. They come from mainland China, and their parents obviously, you know, China is a special case. We need the CCP, the strong leadership to take us through this. We can never be like America, right? I think first thing that we can have is like compassion. Like if we were raised in that system every single day throughout that brainwashing, I don't know if I could have turned that differently. But after the compassion, I guess we should like read more books. You know, there's many great books like George Orwell's 1984, Animal Farm, or The On Liberty by. There's a lot of great classical books that really help you understand what it means to be free, why freedom is essential for our flourishing as a humanity. And I think especially now in China, even till this day, like with the social credit system, right? Chinese people are not that free. So I do think that it just comes from self-education. And I think we have to go back, deleting our TikTok and our social media, going back to library and reading classical works of the books that help build this kind of nation. And once we go back to true knowledge of freedom and human history, I do think we have hope. The problem is we are a TikTok generation of people who think watch some 30 seconds video, they know everything about history. It's a real problem. I really think that this is like the end of civilization that I'm witnessing, how people don't read books, you know, and people don't know real history. So it should be a very important thing anybody to now going back to reading books. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming to speak. My question is, what is the most surprising thing that you sort of realized or came upon whenever you came to America?
I mean, where do I begin, right? There's so many culture shock that I felt is the hardest concept that I had to understand was that how come having no problem is a problem? So let me explain more. Like, I came to America, like, I have friends in their 20s, and my friends, like, girlfriends calls me the next day in tears, and like, why are you crying? And like, I need to talk. And turns out some guy she went on a date with doesn't call her back. And this is kind of the trauma for her that she needs to go to see a therapist. Or like how people are saying America is so bad because there are so many delicious food. It's like, you simply don't have to eat them if you want to say thing, but the temptation is real. That's oppression, right? So it's the how people expect life to be so unbelievably easy. That's very weird to me because, I mean, life is tough. I mean, seriously, it's really tough. Life is not easy. And somehow Americans were so in an overprotection mode since they were born. Like, I have a child, like he has a, I couldn't even put a single blanket in his crib because he might get like conditions. Like literally so much safety that he goes through, everything wears a helmet, right? And it doesn't prepare us for the real world. And I think that's why we see so much anxiety, so much over-medication that I see. I came to America and people were saying like, Yeonmi, you have a PTSD, you need to go see a therapist. I was like, hell no. What's the problem? What's the point of me surviving all of it and now I'm gonna spend the rest of my life complaining about it? Like, so there's no point for it. At least for me it was that case. But in America, there's almost expectation for you not to do what if you had a difficulty. And so I do think that I hope the Americans someday realize that humans are a lot stronger than we think. We are very resilient creatures. We can overcome so much. But this spirit is not reminded in the name of just protecting people. And I think that is the one sign of a safe space that I witnessed in college campuses too. Yeah, thank you.
All right, this next question is going to be our last question for the night.
Well, like everyone else, I want to thank you again for coming out tonight. So communism, especially in America, is more popular than ever. We see it all over campuses, and not just in America, but places like Europe, other parts of Asia. How do you suggest we go about fighting that around the globe?
With facts. I mean, I think Ben Shapiro is right. The facts don't care about your feelings. However you feel about communism, however these words of the equity, equality of outcomes make your heart warm in any way, socialism, communism is completely evil. Even when you decorate it with the word democratic socialism, it's still evil. Did you know that North Korea is not North Korea? It's DPRK. It's a Democratic People's Republic of Korea. It's democratic and it's republic, and but still socialism. So I do think that we need a re-education. Like we really do need a re-education, not about the, you know, just like microaggression training, but we need a re-education on learning actual history of socialism and communism. Because we are not being taught a lot about these horrors of socialism, now we wanna repeat the history. And it is a thing, we learn that when we don't learn from history, we repeat it ourselves. So I think it only comes from education, and I hope you guys be that teacher to other people, be the teacher to your children, to your friends, and wake them up from the horrors of communism. And don't buy anything when it sounds so wonderful. Like, you know, tyranny always comes with compassion. Did you know that? The paths are like paved with great promises, like North Korea. And so be realistic and learn that nothing is free in the world. So thank you so much, everyone. I'm so grateful and hope to see you soon. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.